सर शैल वी स्टार्ट?
ओके आई कैन स्टार्ट जो समस्त ज्वाइन है ये तो स्टार्ट कर दो। हाँ मैडम सभी को मैडम
यस सर।
इधर मैंने लैंग्वेज ही इंग्लिश चलो ना हिंदी की उड़िया दैट प्राइमरी कंसर्न
एस
दैट
यू
योर फैमिली
कंफर्टेबल सर, सेमती किसी भी नहीं, टोटली
नहीं
इंग्लिश
नहीं
हेले भी चलिव, बायलिंगुअल हेले भी चलिव,
ओके नहीं नहीं बहुत जन
इट इज
स्टूडेंट बाहर उतार
कंप्लीटली
चुके
अप टू
हैं।
यू सर।
ओके ठीक ओके
सर आवर स्टूडेंट्स आर मच मोर कैपेबल, बट इट इज अप टू यू सर, व्हाट एवर लैंग्वेज यू
नहीं
प्रेफर।
नहीं एक्चुअली कौन आम मुझ आगे क्लास में उठी तो सेपाई से प्रिफर बेसी हिंदी पे कौन से पचारदेली। ओके
नो नो, इट इज अप टू यू सर, अप टू यू
ओके
सर।
ओके ओके गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल माई सेल्फ सोन कुमार पांडे।
सर जस्ट जस्ट अ मिनट, लेट मी इंट्रोड्यूस यू। वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल द लर्नर्स। टुडे वी हैव अनदर क्लास ऑफ आवर मास्टर इन साइबर सिक्योरिटी, दैट इज द कोर्स कोड इज CSP16, व्हाइट हैट हैकिंग। सो फॉर टेकिंग द क्लास वी आर फॉर्चुनेट टू हैव मिस्टर सोहन पांडे सर। ही इज एन असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर इन सिलिकॉन इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ टेक्नोलॉजी संबलपुर, एंड ही इज ऑल्सो काउंसिलर ऑफ OSOU इन वन ऑफ द स्टडी सेंटर ऑफ संबलपुर। सो नाउ आई विल रिक्वेस्ट सोहन सर टू टेक द सेशन। सोहन सर प्लीज।
थैंक यू मैडम गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल। एक्चुअली व्हेन वी आर टॉकिंग अबाउट एथिकल हैकिंग और व्हाइट हैट हैकिंग और ग्रे हैट हैकिंग वी हैव ऑलरेडी कम अक्रॉस दिस टाइप ऑफ वर्ड्स। ओके ज़्यादातर टाइम मैं हिंदी में रहूँगा क्योंकि कोई किसी को प्रॉब्लम भी हो सकता है इंग्लिश में और कुछ इजीनेस के लिए मैं हिंदी में भी बोलूंगा। ओके दैट विल बी फाइन फॉर ऑल इंग्लिश हिंदी दोनों मिक्स अप रहेगा। ओके तो हम जब एक व्हाइट हैट हैकिंग के बारे में
मिस्टर
गुड
पांडे,
मॉर्निंग यस सर
आई फील एंड सागरिका मैम ऑल्सो, आई फील मोस्ट ऑफ आवर स्टूडेंट्स आर कंफर्टेबल इन इंग्लिश एंड द टॉपिक इज
ओके सर
इंटरेस्टिंग। इट शुड बी इन इंग्लिश ओनली, प्रिफरेबली, अनलेस यू हैव एनी प्रॉब्लम।
नो नो आई डोंट हैव एनी प्रॉब्लम
प्लीज देन
एक्चुअली।
क्लियर, इन केस एनी स्टूडेंट हैज एनी प्रॉब्लम दे कैन रेज देयर हैंड। ओके थैंक यू।
ओके थैंक यू सर दैट ओके ओके देन व्हेन वी आर स्टार्ट टॉकिंग अबाउट व्हाइट हैट हैकिंग ब्लैक हैट हैकिंग और ग्रे हैट हैकिंग These are the different types of storms we are coming across in our world. Okay, then when we heard any word of like hacking, we just get anxiety, excited that can we do a hacking or our system is hackable or we can generally when I take the classes, general students ask that can we hack the Facebook account or Instagram account like that type of question. Because going to that part, hacking a social account or hacking a system or I can hack a laptop. But we have to know what are the procedures, what are the systems, what are the technology available, is that the thing is available, or if I am going to hack any system, if I am going to attack any system, is I am safe from the attacker? That is the main concern about these type of studies. So in this white hat hacking class, we are not going to hack any system. We are not going to learn how to hack a system, but we are going to learn how to protect our system, how to protect ourselves from being attacked by different kind of hackers or different kind of attackers, cyber crimes, how we have to protect ourselves from those different kind of cyber crimes. That is our power primary concern in this learning class. Okay, that's what my first point. Now, what are we going to study here? Okay, first I be, what is hacking? Hacking means what? Hacking means there are different types of terms. I'm first explaining different types of terms like hacking, cracking, virus, trojan. These are kind of different terms we are going to learn in this session. Okay. And what is a hacking? Hacking means something, suppose there is an information in a system and there is an user. Always there is a user for a system. If any unauthorized user is trying to access that system or that information, then we can say that he is trying to hack the system. It is a simple definition I am giving, but it is not that like that simple. Actually, when an unauthorized user is trying to gain the access of the system or going to take the advantage of the data, then we can say that is a hacking. But actually, when any user, why a user will take to use the data or why unauthorized user will try to access the system? Because today, the person which has a lot of data, which has a lot of information, he is rich. I can say in the today technical world, I can say that the person having a large amount of data, he is rich. Because you can say that the person, suppose, I am giving a small example. In last year or day before, one or 2 years before, Facebook purchased WhatsApp. Means if the Facebook purchased a software or a APK or database, no. That is the total purchase of the database of the people. What is the database of the people? Database is certainly linked with the identification, phone number, address, and other details of the people that are stored in the WhatsApp server. And simply, WhatsApp server stores the total identification data to private, or we can say that the data we have shared with the WhatsApp server that was sold by the WhatsApp server to the Facebook server or Facebook owner. This is a simple kind of thing. So what do you mean by data? Then I am going to explain what is a data. Okay, what is a data? I'm audible. Hello, madam.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes,
sir. Completely audible.
Okay. Okay. Yeah, very clear. Black box situation, I am not getting feedback. Okay. I'm going to. What is a data? First, we have to check what is a data. Data means it is the information about the information. We can say that information. We can hear the words like database, RDBMS. These are kind of different things we have already learned or we have studied in our computer science, general computer science subjects. Okay, what is a data? Data means it is the information about the information. What is a knowledge? It is the data about the data. It's called knowledge. Okay, and we are in a world that is we are going for into artificial intelligence system or different kind of system. The main core part of the artificial intelligence system or main part of the technical world is data. Suppose my data is vulnerable. Suppose I have some data stored in a server and that is the server is located abroad India. Then I can I be sure that my data is secure? Or I am worried about that my data can be hacked or can be compromised by the organization or can be compromised by the server. Okay, these are the different kind of concerns. Okay, then I am going for straightly. I am going for hacking. Okay, hacking means there are generally three groups of hackings. Okay, hacking means there are three groups of one. They have categorized into black hat hacking, white hat hacking, and generally gray hat hacking. The gray hat hacking is not important. Technically, there are two types of hacking: white hat hacking. White hat hacking and black hat hacking. That means white hat hacking or black hat hacking, what are these kind of terms? Okay, simply kind of thing that when an attacker is attacking a system or attacking a database or on going to gain the unauthorized access, it is kind of stealing. And stealing is always illegal thing. Stealing is always illegal thing. We cannot justify an illegal thing by some laws. Okay, that's the first concern. Then there are two types of things. One, there is a thief and another is a police. We can say that the white hat hackers, who are the white hat hackers? The white hat hackers are doing the research, how to protect the system. They are exploiting the black holes or loopholes through the system, through the database, through the server, or through the software to fix that box, fix the issues, so that the system will not be attacked by the attackers. And who are the black hat hacking? What is the black hat hacking? The persons who are intentionally attacking the systems, financial institutions, banking institutions, government servers to access the data and to do some harmful things to the public or harmful things to the user, government, or any other of the things, then that will say that there is a black hat hacking. Or if there is no limitation that white hat hacking can do these things or black hat hacking that could include this type of thing. No, there is a thin layer between them. Okay, simple. I can say that if the hacking procedure or the exploitation procedure is for goodwill or for the benefit of the people, of benefit of the society, then we can say that white hat hacking. Otherwise, it will be categorized as the black hat hacking. Okay, that's the simple term. There are two terms: white hat hacking and black hat hacking. And gray hat hacking, it is in between them, in between the black hat hacking and white hat hacking. Then there is a script kiddies. What do you mean script kiddies? Script kiddies means, suppose in general terms, we are coming across how to, we are Google, then some people Google that how to hack a Facebook account. Then there are that 10 to 20 list of URLs or websites. They are giving different kind of tools
they use these tools to access the password, use this tool to access the software, or use this tool to key logger to crack the operating system. So this kind of, I can say that the person who are going to use that, he has not developed the key scripts. He's just using the scripts without knowing the actual the structure, or actual the programming language of the tool. Then we can say that script kiddage. Okay. Then there is activities. Then what are the activities? Means that is some kind of social engineering. We are getting different kind of social message in Facebook or in Google or different kind of our social platform. If you are getting different kind of message for message, that is like threaten. I am going to explain how the social messages are also are vulnerable for our data. Then I will going to explain this. Okay, these are kind of hacking or terms. And the second thing is, what are the different kind of cyber crimes we are telling about? Okay, then that is your first one is your computer fraud. Computer fraud means computer fraud means when a system, that may be system, may be a standalone system, or that system may be a connected system or a network, or system may be part of a network. Then computer fraud means one person is intentionally going to access personal data stored in that system. That is computer fraud. And we can say that there is also privacy violation. Because suppose last month or in the recent days, there is a message floating in around our social network that Arogya Setu app is vulnerable for attackers, or is our privacy or personal data can be exploited or can be hacked by different organization or the different attackers. There are different kind of social rumors are going around. So what is the possibility? We are going to discuss about it. Okay, this is the kind of privacy violation. Identity theft. Identity theft means stealing personal information from somebody and impersonating that person. Means that suppose I am going to access a Facebook account, but that is not my Facebook account. I am going to steal another Facebook, or I am going to try to log in into some different user's Facebook account. Then I can say that I have to use that person's email ID and I have to guess some password. But it is not kind of easy that just guessing a password that will be allow you to access to that profile. That is not easy thing. But identity theft is kind of thing that some person, suppose there is a system, some person is saying to the system that I am not X, I am Y. And he is going to access the system with the privilege of with the privileges of Y. What are the privileges got by the Y? He's trying to get the privilege, but he's actually X, he's not Y. This is kind of identity theft. Okay. There is different kind of electronic fund transfer.
Sohan sir, excuse me, sir. Yes, sir. Sorry to interrupt you. Sir, okay. I would like to request you, if there will be any presentation, you can share with our learners so that they can be easily able to get properly.
Okay.
If you want to share, sir, it is up to you, but I am just requesting only.
Okay, actually I got the information yesterday, so I did not have any type of presentation. I have not prepared any type of presentation.
Okay, no, sir. You can also share your screen, sir. Whatever any document is there, you can also share that.
Okay, I will go for that. When okay, there will be a diagram, I will go for that.
Yes, sir.
Okay. 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 Then we are talking about. When we are talking about ethical hacking, suppose we are talking about ethical hacking. So then when we are going for ethical hacking or learn about ethical hacking, we have to aware of different kind of technology. First one is your programming language. And what is the server? What is the data? How the server works? If you don't know what is the server, what is the IP address, what is the programming language available, we will not be able to access that system, or we are not able to hack the system. Okay. First one is a programming language. What is a programming language? Programming language is simply a language that will enable us to interact with the system. That means we have to write a code, and after compiling the code, there will be executable file, and the executable files do whatever we want to desire or what. Simple thing is that the different kind of programming is C++, Java, Python, Perl, Ruby, PHP, JSP, and different kind of languages are present in there. But simply I am saying about Facebook. Then the total site is developed with PHP server. Google is using Python, C++, or different kind of Ajax, different kind of things. Okay. Then we have divided. It is not in the book. I am discussing these things. There are different distinction between the language. What is server side? What is the client side? Suppose. Okay. Suppose HTML, JavaScript, CSS, these are the kind of client-side languages. When we are talking about JSP, PHP, .NET, these are the server-side language. Then what do you mean by server-side language and client-side language? Suppose we are using a website, and the first thing we can see in our interface, these are those were developed by the client-side language, because the website we see that developed with HTML, CSS, JavaScript. But we cannot see the language when we are viewing any website. Just right click on the website and we can see the source code, but in the source code that we can only see the what is the HTML code, what is the CSS code, what is the JavaScript code. But what are the server side code? That server side code is present, but we cannot see that code. That is JSP, PHP. Okay, then when there is an interaction between them, the first thing is that the server side code or language will accept our data and send the data to the server side language. And server side language or server side, it will act as a middle layer, and it will send the data to the database. Simple thing. That means when I am providing any data in HTML page, there will be HTML form. The data will be inserted in the HTML form. Then after I'm hitting the click button, I'm hitting the OK button, the data will be sent to the JSP part. And JSP part will evaluate those codes or those data, and it will store the data into the database. Then when this is the actual process, when I am accessing any Facebook account, and when I am going to access any Google account, Gmail account, simply I am going to enter the data, or I am going to enter the credentials, and the credentials will be verified by the JSP code. And JSP code will have to access the database, and after fetching the data from the database, it is going to validate the data. Then what? Throughout this communication, there are different stages. Why I am saying that there are different stages? Because when you are actually using a system, you require an internet, you require a system, you require an interface. Then in the middle layer, there is a server, and after the server, there is a database. Okay. So when we are actually want to, what are the loopholes? Or what are the loopholes that will be treated so that our system cannot be hacked? First thing is that then, when we are actually using an interface, or when we are actually using an internet, then suppose I have a system, it is connected to my personal mobile Wi-Fi, and I am using I am using Mozilla Firefox Chrome. Okay, then when I am entering the data, after the data is entered to the Google form or into the Facebook account, it will be encrypted into some languages, with some encryption keys. There are different kind of encryption technology available, and so you can, there are some encryption technology you are using by WPA, WPS, and IDEA, SHA algorithm. These are the different kind of algorithms. Okay, then what is the process? Whenever we are entering any username and password, these are the encrypted. How it is encrypted? It is the SSL encryption. Suppose for Facebook or Google account or banking account, these data are encrypted with SSL encryption. SSL encryption is 1024 bit. We are using 1024 bit SSL encryption. After the encryption, the data is sent over the channel, and it will be sent to the JSP server or server present at the we can say it is abroad. It can be inside our country. Then that data will be validated, and that will be inserted to the database. Then what are the loopholes throughout the communication? What are the loopholes? First thing is that when we are using an internet, if the internet is connected to our personal network, then there is a security kind of thing. But when you are using any public Wi-Fi, then there will be a problem that, yes, because public Wi-Fi is provided by someone, if the traffic is monitored, that is called packet sniffing. If the traffic or the data will be monitored by someone, then there is a chance that the person providing the Wi-Fi can access our data or can hear the data, can hear the data, because there are different kind of tools like packet sniffer or different kind of tools. I will discuss in later. What are the tools are used for? Their tools generally listen to the data, listen to the traffic sent over the channel or sent over the Wi-Fi or the network to gain the access. Actually, they are not seeing what is the data sent or what is the username or password sent, but there is a possibility. Suppose you are using the same name, same password, will repeated time, then there will be packet sniffer which is going to listen the data, listen those data, and that will go for statistical or password directory attack, rainbow attack. Different types of attacks are there. Dictionary attack, different types of attacks are there. He's going to try those kind of attacks after sniffing the packets. Their packets are sent over the network, and he's going to explore the things. This is the first thing. This is the first loophole. So then we don't have to use the public Wi-Fi for the sake of goodness. Okay. Then we are going to about the use of that software. Suppose if you are getting any mail, actually these are the different security standards followed by the different servers or different companies followed by the organization. They are giving out, they are actually providing the services to us. Okay, simple thing. For example, we are using a banking financial service of onlinesbi.com or onlinesbi.in. There are different domain names. Okay. When you are using these two websites, they are giving different kind of certain standards to use those websites. But when you are not following those websites, means what is that? Okay, they are simply asking that, or they are simply many times they are saying that we don't send any type of email or any type of message to you through any mail or message to you for recording or accessing your password or different kind of things. Okay. Suppose I have a situation. I'm just giving an example. Suppose I have a situation. I got a mail. How do you get a mail? Suppose I got a mail from SBI's financial security for users. Okay. There's a website is called SBI financial security for users. There is no such kind of website present in the net. But suppose I got a mail from that kind of website, and it is SBI financial security for users. Okay, I got the mail. In the mail, it has written that your account is compromised and someone was trying to access your website or your mail account. Please click the link below to access or regain the username and password or reset your account. Simple thing is that. Okay, then you will be freaked out. What is this message? Why I am getting this message? You will be freaked out, and we are going to hit the link bill present at that mail. After clicking that mail, it will be redirected to an website that is not legally validated. Okay, and that is how to distinguish between a legally validated or genuine website and Indian fake website. I will tell about that. Then after going to that, after clicking on that website, that will, the look and feel will be same. The look and feel will be same, totally same, just like online website, onlinesbi.com. For the URL will be some kind of different thing, or there may not be present of HTTP or HTTPS. I will explain what is HTTP and what is HTTP. Then you are going to enter the username password, because you are going to feel that this is a genuine website, and we are going to enter the username and password. After the username and password is entered by you on that form, the username password is sent to the server. You don't know, and you will be again redirected to on anything page like that. Your account is recovered, and you are not going to redirect to the online SBI server. No, there may be a chance that after the giving the username password, you will be redirected to the original site. But the thing is that in the total meantime, the middle website that you access or that you enter the password and password on that website, that was fake. But what is the process? How to do that? I am saying it is the user view. But who is accessing, who is attacking you? How you will do that? Suppose I am explaining that. How you will do that? Suppose he have to do some statistical work. or he has to do some research work. And that is, their research was is called fruit painting. This their research was called fruit painting. Fruit painting, or you can reconstruction. You will be, come across this word reconstruction in your book. Okay. What do you mean that? This means survey. Suppose you want to attack something, that means we have to survey that person physically or technically. Simple thing here. Physically and technically means that we have to first know, we have to first understand that if this person that you are attacking, going to attack, is he using a mobile version or app version, web version, or which type of operating system he use, which type of network he use, does he use public Wi-Fi, does he use mobile Wi-Fi, or these are kind of, these are the different things we have to first learn. What are the physical things? Now, how to do that? Then thing is that how to do that? If you are going to attack some organization, we are going to attack some user or organization. There are different kinds. Either you can attack organization, either you can attack user. But how to know that? What are the different kind of techniques he used? What are the technicalities? No. Then suppose it is your friend. So in our hacking technology, in our hacking world, in our technical world, I always say that physical security is 100% and technical security is 50%. It is two times. If your system, if your mobile system or different kind of gadgets you are using, it is physically 100% secure, then you are secure. It may not be harmed by 50% of technical issues. Okay. Suppose the attacker, I terminated A. A comes to know that you are using a mobile system or Wi-Fi system, and that mobile system or system or computer system, it is not his personal, it is a public system, a public public computer. Okay. Then second thing is that what are the types he using? He using browser or any application? That is also required to know that what is the user, because if you are using a mobile app, that is another thing. If you are using the accessing the system through your web browser, Google Chrome or Firefox, that is another thing. There are different kind of procedures. Then you will ask, sir, if the person is using this personal, how we will know that the he is using a web browser, it is Firefox, Chrome, it is operating system Windows or Linux? How we will know that? It is impossible thing, right? Okay. Then the actual role comes into the play. It is the language. At the beginning, I have already explained that there are different types of languages. One is client side, another one is server side. And main thing is client side, there is a JavaScript program. I have already told that JavaScript program is a client side program. Now, what is the role of that JavaScript program? Actually, JavaScript program collects different kind of personal, different kind of information regarding your operating system, regarding your browser, regarding your connectivity, regarding anything, everything you are communicating your system, or each and every detail of your system will be collected by the JavaScript. Okay, suppose you are using Chrome, that will be known by the server that you are using Chrome and you are using web browser. Then here the game comes to the play. If you want to access or gain some personal information, you have to develop a JavaScript code. You have to develop a JavaScript code, and you have to send that JavaScript code to mail or through any kind of thing. There are different kind of things you can send a mail. Okay. Suppose I am developing a JavaScript code. And the JavaScript code, what does the code? You can develop also in C, C++, but you have to adequate knowledge in C, C++, or different kind of language to develop this kind of course. I'm going to explain all this thing. Okay. Suppose you have developed a JavaScript and you have sent it like an attachment. It's like an attachment to the individual or to the victim. You have selected a victim. Then you have to send an attachment file with a JavaScript code. Okay, there are two kinds of things. I have already explained. There are four black hat hackers, and one other is script kiddies. Script kiddies means we are not going to develop that code. We are just going to use that code. Then there is a dangerous thing. You are going to attack the victim, and will be also a victim for the code. Then there is not guaranteed that you will be safe. You are using that JavaScript code. Okay. then the JavaScript code will is sent by the attachment file. Suppose there is a technique that after the mail is received by the victim will open that mail, and that is my mail regarding that what will be written in that mail. This is a simple mail sent from the security, etc., etc. And you have just to run, click the below link to get some information regarding aisa kuch hoga, and there will be some mail or application. And after clicking that information or clicking that link, the some kind of software or background software that may not be visible to you, that may not be visible to, but the application will run and install some spyware or install some batch file onto the system. And what are the role of that batch file or software of the system? That will collect the different data present to your actual system, and to send whenever we're going to connect to the internet, it will send those data through email or through any kind of technique back to the attacker. Then the attacker has gained some kind of information. What are the different kind of technology you are using? After gaining that information by the attacker, he is going to do second stage. First thing, he has to get some kind of personal or technical information. After the getting the technical information, suppose I am going with an example. Okay. Suppose I want to access the Facebook.com, open my friend. Suppose they let the friend name is X. Okay. Then what will I do? I have to first get the what are the information. After this JavaScript coding, or I will get the information. Or if there are different kind of things that this is the one technique to getting the information by going through JavaScript code or email attack. Second thing is that if he is using public IP or if he is using public computer, then I can go for packet sniffers also. What do you mean packet sniffers? Packet sniffers can be installed, or listeners, can be installed on the modem on the server side, because someone is providing one Wi-Fi, he can use some kind of sniffers things. But then what are the sniffers things do? They will listen to the packets that were sent over the channel, and the data will be collected. After the collecting the data, I am going to analyze the data. Okay, I'm going to analyze the data in the way there are different kind of hash techniques to exploit the password. Suppose these things. Okay, then when I get the information, I'm going to rebuild the website. The look and feel will be same as the website. So that means I am going to design a Facebook website that is same login page with same all the things, and I have to buy purchase a website or purchase a domain name. Domain name means there is a domain name. If you are using like .com, it is these are the domain names. Domain name means every website there is a domain name. There is an organization that may be .com, .org, .in. They say we can say that osu.ac.in. These are kind of domain names and the name. But I'm not going to explain later what are the domain names. Okay. Then I have to purchase a domain. If I'm going to do the things really hard, then I have to purchase the domains. Okay. Then when I'm going to purchase the domain, I have to do some familiar name. Suppose FacebookSecurities.com. Technically, FacebookSecurities.com is not present or not a genuine website, or it is not present inside. But it must be sound like it is a genuine website. Okay. Then after the things, FacebookGenuine.com or FacebookSecurities.com, that will be, I have to verify for HTTP or HTTPS. Or it is like kind of hard thing to get me HTTPS security verified. HTTPS stands for security. It is hard to get me HTTPS verified. Then, when I will develop, I have to develop two things. First page is same look like Facebook. And second thing is a database thing. What is the database thing? Database thing is it will store the data entered into the form, and it will store the data into the database. Then I have to create the page that look like Facebook and send the Facebook to the victim. If he is using that Facebook account or Facebook page, actually he is not going to directly access that page. You have to send that page over through some TCP, over through HTTP, or over through UDP. What is TCP? It is transaction protocol, transaction control protocol, HTTP hypertransaction protocol, and UDP, user datagram protocol. These are kind of different things. Then, so apart from this kind of protocol, there is ICMP protocol, IGMP protocol, So many protocols are available there. You can use any type of protocol to send that attachment to him. After getting that attachment, he will enter the password. And after entering the password, you have to redirect that page into genuine website. Okay, I am redirecting him to the genuine website. And after getting the password, I will store that password onto my system, on my database. Okay. It is this, these are the simple things many attackers do. But what are the things we have to do to secure ourselves from this type of attacks? I just given demo how to do this kind of thing. But what are the techniques we have to use? Suppose if I am using any email account, okay, email account, I can get email from anywhere, but sharing an email ID, it is kind of obvious thing. We are sharing an email ID on social sites or different websites, so one can easily get the email ID. But when you are using any kind of email ID and you are getting a message that your account is hacked or your account is compromised, there may be a chance. There may be that it may be genuine, maybe fake. How we can verify that it is the mail is fake? Okay, then first thing, you don't click on that link provided in that mail. Just go to the directly go to the website in by entering the URL, not by clicking any link. It is the first mistake and the very one mistake done by every user by clicking the link. No, just don't click the link. Go to the web browser and enter the URL properly and access the site. If there will be any alarm or there will be warning message, there will be displayed on your website. But don't follow the link. In before 2 to 3 years, there was a attack like WhatsApp. There was an attack like. Sagar madam, can you remember that attack that 3-4 years back? I just forgot the name.
WannaCry.
I'm going to explain the what is WannaCry. WannaCry is that suppose the WannaCry was something that the mail was sent by the attackers, and generally it was attacked by email. Many of the things it was attacked by email, and there comes the thing. After getting the email, there was the link. After clicking the link, the total system was encrypted by some key. And if you are not going to pay them some ransom, that will not decrypt, or you cannot access anything, or your data will be lost, kind of thing. Okay, there are the two situations. Who are the attackers? How did they able to do this kind of thing? I am going to explain. But first thing is, there was also email attachment. The thing is that I am saying that most of the 90% of the attackers are doing this kind of thing. I am just explain the process that is called phishing, email attachment, URL access. Another term I am going to explain, JavaScript browser thing. Okay. When you are using any Facebook account, you may come across some certain kind of pictures or videos. It may be vulgar, actually. We come across the kind of things. Okay, it may be vulgar or different kind of excitement, science things. Okay, and it will ask that if you want to watch this video, click the link. You are going to click the link, it is not harmful. But after the clicking the link, they are prompting that we have to verify that you are a human being and you are not a robot, but actually it is phishing. And you have to verify those things, you have to copy the URL and paste in the below section, below textbook. But what is the thing is that, because I have already told that client side information is stored in some kind of JavaScript format or in cache and cookie format. What do you mean cookie? I'm going to explain. What do you mean cookie and what do you mean cache memory? Suppose if you are accessing any website, for example, Facebook. Simple thing is, when after logging into the Facebook, the next time you are opening that browser, you are not asked to enter the password or username or password. Why is that? Because your credential is stored in the form of key or form of cookies in your system. There is some text file and that stores the information. What are the login information that is stored in your system? I'm explaining that the information is stored in your system in form of any cookies. That generally the cookie is not decrypted by the thing. But if you're going to serve those kind of cache on cookies thing, it may be vulnerable. I'm not up to the thing that anyone can easily decrypt the cookies things and going to access your login password. It's not like that. But there is a vulnerability situation. Or in earlier days, there was a situation if you are going to copy paste the URL and put the things in the text box and be sending them, they can access your website. Because there are two factor, after that, there come two factor authentication, two factor authorization means you have to get the OTP also on mobile device. Okay. These are the kind of different kind of security attacks. Then I am going to explain what are the actually WannaCry did. Actually, we are going to this kind of world. When I was studying BTEC, I asked sir, cybercrime sir, what is the possibility? What is the possibility my account will be get hacked? Simple question. What is the possibility my account will be get hacked? And that is the simple question asked by defense. Then he told me a simple answer. Simple answer. There are two parties. One is provider party, another is user. That means Facebook provider, I am the user. And the thing is that if there will be a situation like your account will be hacked or your account will be compromised in two cases. If you are doing any mistake or the provider is doing any mistake. Simple thing. If the provider is doing any mistake or I am doing the mistake, then the two cases, there will be your system will be hacked or your account will be compromised. Otherwise, there is 0% chance. I can say that there is 0% chance that your account will be compromised. Thing is simple. Then, how to do that? Suppose you are the attacker. How to do that? You have to intimidate a person to do the mistakes. Because he cannot do force the developer or cannot force the organizer or organization to do the mistakes. He will most probably do you or give you intimidate or if you provoke to do some mistakes. It's the simple thing. Then if you are going to do any type of mistake, your account is compromised. Simple thing. Okay. Then going back to WannaCry. We are just discussing about WannaCry. And what do you know? What is the actual procedure? Okay.
Excuse me, Pandey. What is the term exactly you are using? One hacker.
Sorry, WannaCry, bhai.
Can you please spell it? I'm not able to really understand.
Okay, one second.
WannaCry. Okay. Okay. Got it. Thank you.
WannaCry.
Got it.
WannaCry, bhai. Okay. Actually, thing is that I am going with my experience. When I was doing MTech, there was a situation like that. My friend, I'm giving an example. What did he do? My friend was using Windows. I'm specifically telling that he was using Windows 10 platform to access internet. But his Windows 10 was genuine. Mark my points. His Windows 10 was genuine. He was accessing Facebook or some kind of Skype things through Wi-Fi. But he was not using his personal Wi-Fi. He was using college Wi-Fi. I'm not talking about Sambalpur University. When he was present in hostel, he was using public Wi-Fi. Public Wi-Fi means Sambalpur University Wi-Fi. The problem is that he was talking with his friend or whatever the thing. Was talking friend with video call for whole night. After the thing is that after the conversation, after 2 p.m. or 3 p.m., he got into the sleep, but he forgot to shut down the system. The problem is that when he forgot to shut down the system, the problem was that when he was using the video call in Sambalpur University, that Wi-Fi is provided by Sambalpur University, it was prohibited. You cannot access social network site in that Wi-Fi. Okay. Why I'm saying that you cannot access social network site. Then after the social network site, you cannot access. He was using VPN. VPN means virtual private network. Then when you are using VPN to access that thing, VPN means what? VPN means there is a like of tunnel. Tunnel means the VPN server will be present abroad India. Many times of VPN services are provided abroad. That means the simple your Facebook page will be accessed by the that country, and the data will be encrypted in some format, and the data will be shared by that country to you in a secure channel. This is the work of VPN. Okay. Then the problem was that when he was using the VPN, Windows server, actually there is a Microsoft server always running in background, or there are always detection of Microsoft server that you are using a genuine Windows or fake Windows. Why I am explaining these things, I am going to explain it. Okay, then when you were using that Skype thing through VPN, Microsoft server detected that the person you are using the Windows, it is not genuine. Why?
Yes, sir. Sorry to say, but we are not able to listen, sir.
Okay. All of these those are facing this issue, but, or
no, sir? We are hearing you clearly. I think the learner have some network problem, so might be that problem arise.
Okay, if all listeners are getting audio, there may be a problem from your side. Just check the internet. If there is kind of fluctuation in the network, it may happen. Okay. I'm going with my example. Okay, then okay, when you are using the VPN, the Microsoft server detected that the Windows he was using is not a genuine, it was a fake, because he was using VPN. I don't know how the VPN, how the Microsoft detect that Windows was fake, but actually the server was genuine, the Windows was genuine. Then what is the role of the Microsoft? Actually, Microsoft runs a background check to whether you are using a genuine Windows or fake Windows. Genuine Windows or fake Windows. Then when Microsoft server detected that he was using the fake Windows, he just encrypted all the things, all the data present at the system, present at the laptop, all the Microsoft server. I'm saying that it was encrypted by the Microsoft server. Okay. Hello? Oh, yes, sir.
I request all the learners to just have patience. Sir is coming soon. Okay, before till sir is online, I just want to ask all of you, can anybody define why this term white hat, black hat, or gray hat is introduced in the hacking field? Can anyone have the answer?
Yes, ma'am.
Hello, Amit sir.
Yes, ma'am.
Is there any technical problem with sir, Sohan sir?
Yes, ma'am. Actually, I called him and told him that his voice is not unable. We are not able to hear him. So I told him to please reconnect once again.
Okay, okay, okay.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, he has connected. Hello, Sohan sir. Can you hear me?
Hello.
Sohan sir.
Sir is in mute. Please ask him to unmute.
Sir, can you please unmute your mic, sir? We are not able to hear you. Please unmute your mic.
Okay, okay, okay. Okay.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Now it is audible? Okay.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Please continue, sir.
Okay. 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 I am using my mobile. Okay. I am not using my laptop. It will not be a problem. Okay. Then Actually, when the Microsoft deteriorated the server, that Windows was Genpei, that Microsoft server encrypted whole the system with some kind of encryption keys. And when we try to decrypt the things, it will ask for the passwords or it will ask for the genuine. But it is total system, everything, data, hard disk, RAM, all the things were encrypted. Because you cannot say, we have separated the things like RAM, hard disk, and attached to the different kind of system and try to access those data. And the data were encrypted. And the same thing, where I am actually elaborating this example, because the same thing was done by one actor. Then the question comes, what is the system developed by the Microsoft? Now, what are the main technology behind the one actor? Simple thing, there is a similarity. There is a similarity between them. Because when you are, why I am saying that, there was a similarity. Why there was a similarity? The same encryption procedure, the same thing that was done by Microsoft and was done by the WannaCry, the attackers. And later on, when we are going to discover the kind of attack case, after I am going for the solution part. Okay. What are the solution given by the Microsoft to deal with the WannaCry virus? They told that you have just to update your Windows operating system and you have to don't have to get any type of, there's a patch. Actually, they told me that we are providing a patch file for the operating system and that will be enable you to secure your system from the and from the attackers, or you can retrieve data. Now, what are the whole circle? It makes a circle. It makes a circle. One, what is the circle is that if you are using a fake Windows, if you are using a genuine Windows, you are not able to update your Windows, you are not going to access the patch file. No. How can you access the patch file? You are not going to, certainly not going to access the patch file. The thing is that actually it is not written in the article, because there was a, actually I am explaining the procedure. What is that? Actually, there was a loophole present in the Windows XP. Actually, that was not the loophole. There was a technique developed by the Microsoft to restrict the piracy of the operating system. Because if the number of users increases who are using the pirated version, there will be loss to the Microsoft server. So that's why they developed the encryption things. And later on, the person who attacked the WannaCry who developed the WannaCry, who was using that loophole that was developed originally by Microsoft, that originally developed by Microsoft, he used that technique to get the thing. And certainly it was like an illegal thing, but my instinct said that it was actually an intended thing or intended done by Microsoft, because to restrict the users to do or use the different kind of operations that were already deprived or already restricted. Because the WannaCry was most vulnerable, the operating system was more vulnerable to WannaCry was Windows XP, Windows Vista system. And for your confusion, I can say that the support system for Windows XP was stopped around 2012. And the WannaCry virus attacking it is in between like 2015 and 16. That means when Microsoft announced that you are not going to use Windows XP, but the thing is that many of the users were using Microsoft XP. So that was forced to Microsoft to do some kind of things. So actually we can say that the WannaCry is a legal and attack done by Microsoft. No, we can legally or On the document, we cannot say that WannaCry was attacked by the Microsoft. No, we cannot say that. But thing is that it was some mistake done by the Microsoft system. Either they have leaked the information loophole to the external party, because the person who attacked the system with WannaCry was not part of the Microsoft system, but he was able to gain that loophole. But how can he was able to gain the loophole or the patch file to attack the things? Yes, there may be a leak from the Microsoft side. It is just intent. I'm not saying that. But thing is that when I started the session, I told that there may be two things. Either mistake made by the developer, either made by the you. The WannaCry was the thing is that the mistake was from the developer side. And it was not a mistake, there were attempts to do the things. Actually, there are different kind of regulation to stop the piracy, because there is something ethical lacking, there is something cracking. What do you mean by cracking?
It is not hacking, it is a cracking. We are using different kind of crack softwares also in our system, like our Windows XP, Windows Office, Microsoft Office, Microsoft OS. These are the different kind of things we are also using. Adobe products also on some pirated key, IDEM also pirated key. What are the kind of things? Actually, those who are in university, they may know. Then before 2 to 3 years, there was an official mail sent by all the developers like Windows, Microsoft, Windows, or Adobe, Dreamweaver. These are kind of different developers. They sent a mail to the different organizations, different universities to stop the things, to stop the pirates. Because in many of the laboratories, you can say that you are using Windows XP system, genuine operating system or pirated operating system. Then there was the official mail to stop the things. Thing is that, what is the problem? I'm saying what is the problem. Okay, actually there is a crime value. Actually when we are contacting, actually I explored the thing, there is a crime value. Suppose in the same thing, I just taking an example, I just crossed the red light once. Then what will the traffic police do? He will give me a warning and leave me go, or let me go. But if I'm doing this serious crime, he will going to put me. The same thing applies here. If you are using a single standalone system, then if you are also using a pirated OS or pirated software, that is not going to increase the crime value. Suppose it is a crime value 2 to 3% or 20 to 200% or 300% like that. Because if you are using a standalone system, the point will be less. But if you are using a public Wi-Fi, the problem was, what is that? That with my friend of us, he was using a public Wi-Fi. Then the same total Wi-Fi will be treated as a single system. Total network will be treated as a single system. At that time, the number of users were more. If one user is committing 200 mistakes, then all the users are 400 to 800 users will come crime some very big amount of error, big amount of crime error, and that was lead to Microsoft server to blow the Windows. You are getting my point? Actually, why did the Microsoft? Then you can easily ask, we are going to ask that, why my, I am also using a Windows pirated system. Why my system is not blocked? Why his system was blocked? Yes, his system was blocked because he was using public Wi-Fi. And public Wi-Fi problem is that all the systems connected to the public Wi-Fi treated as a single system because the Wi-Fi, because the IP was a private IP. But the public IP is provided to the organization in a single IP, that will be a public IP. Getting up? That is a IP. IP concept is that there is public IP, public IP and private IP. And if I get time, I will explain that. Okay. This was the actual tragedy. Actual tragedy. The thing is that why I am putting this kind of stories. Thing is that we learn three things from this story. First thing is that if the mistake is done by the developer, we are helpless. We are helpless. Second thing is that email attachment. Every time we are getting an email attachment, we just don't have to go through the email attachment. It is a severe thing. Third thing is that when you are installing any type of software, there is a term called spyware. What do you mean by spyware? Spyware is not kind of harmful to us. It is not kind of harmful. It will not do any kind of harm things to our system, but it will steal our information and pass the information to the attacker. So if you are going to install this kind of spyware, so you are using, you will ask that, why I am going to install the spyware? No, you are not installing the spyware. Actually, the spyware were installed by the side product or byproduct of a large product. Okay, suppose you are exploring some IDM. I am giving an example, IDM crack. If you are going to use any kind of IDM crack, in the meantime, IDM will not be cracked. But in the meantime, some spyware will be installed in your system. And that will lead to steal your information and to send the information to the attacker. There is a possibility. Then the thing is that when you are installing any type of software, then you must be aware of what are the softwares you are installing in your system. Or before installing the system, and I'm giving a small important message. Before installing any software into the system, please check the hash code. What do you mean by hash code? What do you mean by hash code? Hash code means
Suppose there is a data, large chunk of file, large data file, it is around 3 to 4 GB, or 200 MB to 400 MB. Then the data will be feed into an algorithm. And what is the role of the algorithm? So algorithm will generate some hash code. Hash code means it's not like it is 1 MB or 2 MB. No, it's kind of from 512 bits to 14 bits. There are different kind of code. Okay, 252 bits. They're simple. Generally, the SSL length is 512 bits. 512 bits. And whenever you are installing any software, the software SSL code is always present at the website. Okay, that means suppose I am installing any VLC media player. After downloading the VLC media player, we just put or run the algorithm on the hash algorithm on that software. That may be MD5 or SHA, and you will get the same code as present at the website. You are getting, when you are downloading anything from the system, then may must be written the SHA file or SHA code, but given by the SHA code. SHA code means after downloading the file, suppose in the process of downloading file, your file is corrupted. Or if you are downloading from any website like FileHorse, FileIPO, you are not aware that the site is genuine. They may give you fake software, not the genuine software or pirated software. Then you are going to run that hash algorithm on your software and check whether the hash code is same to the code present at the website. If the coding is same, hash code is same, then you can be certain that I got the real software or I got the software that is intact. There is no misconfiguration or no alteration in that software in the process of downloading. First thing is that when you are doing any type of installation in our system, this is the first procedure to prevent the spyware. Every software we are going to download from a genuine website, there will be present a SSH key or MD5 key. You can see that in FileHorse or something. Okay. Then it is the first thing. What is the second thing? We are going to download the genuine software we have installed. We don't have to go through the email. Third thing, don't go for, if you are using any type of public Wi-Fi, if you are using any type of pirated software, generally we are using pirated software. Microsoft, we are not going to purchase Microsoft Office. It is kind of 4,000 rupees. We are not going to 5,000 rupees. We are not going to purchase the Microsoft Office. But we are using, but we are using the thing. So when we are using pirated software, don't copy, go for a public Wi-Fi. There is a possibility your system will be encrypted or your system is vulnerable to the public Wi-Fi. It is the second thing. The next thing. The next thing is that when we are prompted any kind of thing, suppose you are in through mail or through any kind of software, if you are prompted to do certain kind of separate installation means, suppose there is a software you need to access this kind of things, you need to break the firewall, don't go for that. Suppose because any type of software, different kinds of software provided by the different developers, they ask to reduce your security level, they ask to disable your firewall, don't go for that. This kind of diligence. This is a kind of thing. Then second thing is that it is, these are the kind of web security. When we are actually talking about the system security, we very often come to this kind of situation. Sir, my password is lost. How to retrieve the data? I left my laptop in hostel room. Some of my friends get in the laptop and access all the data. How to prevent that? How to do that thing? Or if you want to attack an operating system, how to do that? Okay, simple thing. Okay, when there is a password, okay, actually we are using a Windows and we are giving a password. So what is the password? Password is the kind of thing that is, what is the architecture? We have to learn the architecture of the password. When you are developing or you giving any password, first time it will confirm the password. When you are giving a username, password, confirm password. Then the password will be stored in some kind of table. In Windows, I am specifically talking about Windows. That password will be saved in kind of table. And it is not actually not stored in kind of original form, it is kind of hash form. Hess permit a Hess algorithm. There are different kinds of Hess algorithm, secure Hess algorithm, MD5, message digest 5 algorithm, MD3 algorithm. There are different kinds of Hess algorithm. So Hess algorithm will be run by the operating system, and it will generate some Hess code. And the Hess code will be saved in the Hess table. I'm repeatedly saying that. Again, I'm saying that. First, when you are giving username and password, the password will be run or password will be fed to the Hess algorithm. Hess algorithm will generate some Hess code, and the Hess code will be saved in a Hess table. Okay? And the table is present in your system. That means if anyone tries to access your password, then he has to access the Hess table. He has to access the Hess table. If the attacker is able to access the Hess table, then it is not that he is going to read the Hess value, because it kind of thinks that Hess value is some kind of, you can say that Hess value is an encrypted value. If you are reading a Hess value, you cannot get the what was the password. No, you cannot say that. But thing is, how the process actually works? When the actually authenticated user for the second time going to log into the system, he's going giving the username and password. Then again, the software runs the Hess code or runs the Hess software or hashing algorithm on that code, and it will generate the Hess code. Then it is going for the database and the previously stored the Hess code. It will compare the both Hess code. And after comparing the both Hess code, if the Hess code matches or match the Hess code, then it will allow to enter into the Windows operating system. Simple thing. Okay. But how the attacker will do? There are different kinds of software present in market. Someone is like Opcrack, OPHCRACK, or anything. You're in those two to three softwares are present mentioned in your book also, in your material also. What is the role of that Opcrack system? Opcrack is a LiveOS. I'm specifically saying that Opcrack is a LiveOS. What you have to do? We have to build, or you have to do a LiveOS bootable in a pen drive. You know that how to do a bootable in a pen drive? It is a simple procedure available in the net, but there are certain steps to how to bootable a pen drive. Now, what is my role? I have to boot my pen drive, or I have to make the pen drive bootable with Opcrack. Then I will go for the thing. Okay. Suppose I am X, I am, and my victim is Y. I am going to attack the system of Y. Then what will I do? Simple thing, what will I do? I will go and trying to boot the system. After the, when I click the power button, the first thing which will appear, there is a BIOS. BIOS means the first thing is BIOS, that screen prompts. And the BIOS setting, I have to go for the USB option, USB bootable priority option 1. I will make the priority option 1. Okay. After making the priority option 1, the system will be bootable from the pen drive. After the system covers from the bootable, it will take, if you are using Opcrack, it will take 10 to 15 minutes. 10 to 15 minutes or 5 to 10 minutes, I can roughly say that. After 15 to 10 minutes, the Opcrack will go to the Hess table. Opcrack will crack the access the Hess table. It is only works for the Windows. I am actually saying that it is works for Windows 7 and XP 10, both, all the three systems. It will go for the Hess table and it will retrieve the Hess table. Then I have already told that Hess table does not store any type of password, but it will store the Hess code. But what is Opcrack? The Hess code, there is a possibility. One rule is that if one software or one data, from one data you can generate the Hess code, but one from the Hess code you cannot generate the data. Simple thing is that the straightly is possible from generating the Hess code from the data is possible, but the retrieving the data from the Hess code is not possible. Then what will he do? He actually go for different kind of directory attack, password attack. What do you mean directory attack? Directory attack means suppose generally different passwords used by different users all across the world, they are put in a file, genuine file. For example, different, some users use pass pass@123. It is a genuine, it is a most used password in most of the workers. Pass at the rate 123 or password at the rate 123. This kind of things. This kind of password. So there is a directory. Directory is certain directory. And it is not only the directory. It will also use the personal information. Because for my system, what was the password I am going to give? So I will give Sohan at the rate 123. Sohan at the rate anything. Suppose it may be my birthday. Because today in general day-to-day life, we are keeping some alphanumeric value, number, and some kind of thing. Letter, alphabet number, alphabet letter, special character, and number. This kind of combination, these kind of things are going. So the software will make some content. This kind of software. I'm not saying about only Apcara. These are different kind of things, different kind of software. They will go for any type of combination that will use your personal information. How to get the performance personal information? I've already told how to do for the JavaScript things. That will use the personal information. That will combine your date of birth, your place of birth, or place, any type of event, any type of date, any type of number you are using. Suppose how to get those information? It is obvious. It is present in Facebook. Facebook, you can get any information, personal information in Facebook. Okay. And that is the liberator. So this is the personal information, directory attack, different kind of passwords generally used by different users. They are combined to generate different kind of passwords. And the password will, the hash algorithm will be applied on that passwords, and it will generate hash code. And it will go for the comparison with the hash code. And it will take time, but after a certain time, it will be able to hack the, it will be able to crack the password, or it will be able to retrieve the password. Because the thing, the general thing, we are using some common password. That is the simple thing. Okay. So after the password is visible, it will prompt, these are the different users present in the Windows operating system, and these are the passwords. And it is worse. It works. I have already told many times, Opcrack software works to access Windows operating system, or crack to retrieve any passwords in the operating system. Opcrack works. Or different kind of softwares present in the market also works. So you can easily access your any service or any password, or you can access your friend's system, but don't go for it. But I specifically say, don't go for it. Okay. Don't go for it. Okay. Then what is the thing? Second thing is that, okay, I've already done. So then you will ask, sir, if my laptop is present at my house or my hostel, anyone can access my laptop using this person? Yes, he can use this person. How to prevent it? First thing is that if you are staying in hostel, or you want to prevent or secure your laptop from the attacker, then you have to go for the BIOS password also. Because I've already told, because first the screen will be appeared that you will BIOS. If you want to stop these things, you have to go for the BIOS password. If you are going and giving in a BIOS password, after giving the BIOS password, it will ask the attacker to enter the BIOS password. And the attacker will have no knowledge about the BIOS password, and it will, the thing will be restricted. The thing will be restricted by the user. And I can say that the attacker will not be able to go through the BIOS. If he know the BIOS password, he will going to access the, or he make bootable the thing of using Opcrack or any kind of software. But he doesn't know the BIOS password, he is not going to do that. Then the things become that, is BIOS password is crackable? Yes. BIOS password is not crackable. There is a certain thing, you can reset the BIOS. What is that thing? Because suppose I am saying that, suppose there is, if you are using a laptop, if you are using, I'm talking about CPU. Not I'm using a CPU, I'm not talking about laptop. If you are using a CPU, general monitor system, desktop, go for the system inside the motherboard. If you have to physically do the thing. If you are going to for the physical board, there is a motherboard. You know that what is a motherboard. Okay. There is a motherboard, there is a BIOS battery. There is kind of you can see that battery, larger size of your battery put in your hand watch. kind of battery, and that battery, what is the role of that battery? Actually, it gives the small amount of power to the system, and what is the actually use that of that power to store the time, date, value. These are kind of the BIOS thing, BIOS setting. It actually the thing, remember, there is BIOS memory, date, past date, system. These are kind of small information that was stored in the memory, and to active that memory, there is small need of power is required by that, by the system. And when you have shut down the system, there is no flow of DC current. So the battery comes into the role. It gives the power to the memory. Okay. Then thing is that if near that battery, there is a jumper connection. There is a jumper connection. What do you mean by jumper connection? Simply, there will be three pin. Three in the between the three pin, two pin on the two pins, there will be some black topping, black head type of things, or black box type of thing that will be inserted in first two pins. I'm again saying that in the CMOS, that's called actually CMOS battery, near the CMOS battery, there will be a jumper connection. In the jumper connection, there will be three pins. In the first two pins, there will be a black box kind of thing, small black metal kind of thing, that black plastic. Actually, there is a black plastic kind of thing that will be inserted. What we have to do? Just pick the black thing and put in the next two. There are three. It will be inserted in the first two. Just pick the thing or pick the thing and put into the next two pins. After putting the black thing into the next two pins, just power on your CPU. Power on your CPU for 1 to 2 seconds, not more than. Power on and just power on. In between the time, what is the role of that jumper? It is the jumper connection to erase the BIOS setting. After doing that, all your BIOS setting will be erased. All your BIOS setting will be erased. When he wants the BIOS setting erased, the setting done by the user for the BIOS password, that will be also erased. Simple thing. If you forgot your BIOS password, you can reset that BIOS password through that jumper setting. Okay. After suppose I am the attacker, I will go for the jumper setting. I will pick the black dot and put in the jumper setting. It will erase the password. Now I get to reset. Again to put that black thing in your first two pins. Okay, that is the system is okay. Your BIOS password is clear. Then I am going for the off crack version, pen drive bootable version. Then after that thing, I am going to enable the thing. I am going to enable hash table. The off crack software will access the hash table. It will access the password and it will give me the password. After getting the password, I can log into the Windows operating system. Okay, it is the path. Then, what can I do? I can go for a rootkit. What do you mean by rootkit? Rootkit means any kind of software that runs before the operating system is booted. Before the operating system booted into the primary memory, the rootkit actually runs. And it will actually gather the information and pass to the system. I have to install the rootkit. I can do it manually or I can do it remotely. After installing the rootkit, it will get the information and the sent to the attacker. Now, what are the advantages of the rootkit? The user will not be able to know where is the rootkit is present or not. Simple thing is that. So suppose I do one thing. I want to destroy one system. Suppose it is, these are not the advice I am going to go for it. Suppose I want to destroy one system. What will I do? Simple thing is that I will create a shortcut file. Simple shortcut file. It will write the shutdown command. I will write the shutdown. I'm giving a small example. I'm not giving a very big example. I will write the shutdown command and it will make a shortcut. And after making the shortcut, I will put that shortcut in the startup folder, in the rootkit folder. That means rootkit folder or startup folder. That means when the system will boot, it will execute the startup folder. When the system boots, it will actually ask for the startup folder. Why is startup folder? Just for example, when you are booting in an operating system, the sound devices, drivers, torrent, different kind of things, actually those softwares are started naturally or automatically. Those things are put in the startup folder. Then what I have to do? I have to put that shortcut command for shutdown I have to put that command in the startup folder. Then what will you do when the system will log on to the or boot the system? The startup folder will run, and whenever the startup folder will run, the shortcut will run. Then shortcut will run, it will going to give the shutdown command to the system. That means in shortcut, you're going to on the system. At the same moment, it will give the shutdown system and your system will be shut down. And the user will not be able to start the system. It's a simple technique. The user will not able to start the system. And he has to go for the formatting. He has to go for the formatting. And there is no other option. Yes, there is option. If you are going from any LiveOS, we are going to search that startup folder. You have to delete the rootkit. You have to delete the shortcut file from the startup folder. Then only you are able to log into the system. Otherwise, your system will be blocked. These are kind of things we can use. So what is the lesson? What is the lesson we get from this? First thing is that I have already stated that physical security is must. Simple thing is that your system is vulnerable to the technical issues. There is chance of 50%. Only 50% chance that one has got access to your mobile or system. He can access your data. There is a 50% chance. But if he access your system physically, there is a 100% chance. There is a 100% chance your system will be accessed. Your data will be accessed. Simple thing. Or if you give an email ID or password, or one person know your username password, it will block because there is a two-factor authentication. Some OTP will be sent to your mobile. After entering the mobile OTP, there will be a chance that the user will be logged into the system. There is a 50% chance your system will be hacked technically. But if there is a physical vulnerability, there is a 100% chance that your system will be vulnerable or your system will be dealt with some kind of attack. These are the things. Okay. I will go for another small example. A small example. Suppose, Okay. I have already discussed about physical. Okay. There is a thing is that in the previous days, I come to know that there is an app. There is an app, Arogya Setu. I want to discuss that. Actually, there are two kind of things we can do. Actually, there was a joke. There's Akbar Birbal time joke that or kind of things that Akbar draw a line and ask Birbal, how can you sort that line without erasing it? Without erasing the line, how can you sort that line? Or how can you make this line shorter? Then Birbal, what did Birbal do? Birbal draw a bigger line near that line. Then the other line becomes shorter. Simple thing. Then what is the actually use of that in technical world? Simple thing that in before 1 to 2 years, there was a possibility. I know the actually don't know the actual reason. Some news you can say you can Google it. Sambalpur University website was hacked, or some kind of pornography was published in that website. What was that thing? You know that actually I'm going to explain that. Actually, the thing was done by their Sambalpur NSU website is sambalpur.nsu.ac.in. But what do the attackers do? They develop a website. Just look alike. Sambalpur University, just the look and feel was look at same, but the URL was different because same URL is not cannot be given to two different organizations or two different names or two different hosts. So email was the URL was other than the Sambalpur University.ac.in, but their website was developed. Then when actually how you are using any website or how we are accessing that website, generally we are going for the Google. And Google, in the Google, we are searching Sambalpur University. Actually, it is going for SEO. It is called a search engine optimization. What do you mean by search engine optimization? That means that if you are accessing any website, searching with them keyword, and for more number of times, then the SEO will be higher. Simple, the SEO will be higher. Simple thing is that, just like in last 2 months, some started typing Google, Imran Khan is beggar, Imran Khan is wild beggar. So many searches, it shows that Imran Khan is a beggar, wild number one beggar. How this happened? Because it is a part of the SEO. It's not the fault of the Google. It's the SEO. The word, the keyword used by the users or different users for many times, the SEO of that website will be there. That was the same problem we faced by the Sambalpur University website, because Sambalpur University website is not accessed by so many people. There's limited number of people they are accessing the Sambalpur University. But when the attacker created a website that will be with a fake name, with a fake name or fake email ID, that may be not a genuine URL. So I can give an example: sambalpuruniversity.ac.org or Sambalpur University study. This is not a genuine email, genuine URL. They have just started, and we can do the SEO by some programming language. If you have no idea about any programming language, you can do the SEO. What will the SEO do? SEO will do the optimization. Search engine optimization will do the optimization for that website. That means when a new user will enter Sambalpur University on the Google form, the genuine website will be shown in the second or third row, and the fake website will be shown in the first row. And we are not going to confirm that it is the genuine or fake. We are just clicking the first row. Generally, when we are Google, do any Google thing, we are going for the first row. And first row, when we are clicking the first row, it will open the fake website. These were the same problem done by the Sambalpur website. That means the Sambalpur University website was not hacked. But in parallel to that website, that fake website was created, and the SEO of that website was increased. This is the thing. In recent past, 1 or 2 days before, I got to the information that got news that the fake Arogya Setu app. Arogya Setu app uploaded into the Google Play Store. How to know that this is the verified or not verified? When you are using, I am again saying, when you are downloading any Arogya Setu app, just go for the author. There is in the below section or the in the information section, there must be written the developer thing. And in the developer thing, there must be a MyGov, and it will be a verified user. My government of India is a verified user, a verified developer. There must be written government of India verified user. If there is Arogya Setu app is verified by the government of India developer, then you have to download. Otherwise, don't download that APK. It is just for general information, because it's floating around the social network, social platform sites. Okay, these are kind of things. I've already discussed different kind of things. What are the different rules? If anyone has any question, you can ask me.
Thank you very much, sir, for such an informatic idea with lively real world example. Sir, I request you just go through the chat box. I will read the questions. One of the student has asked, if my IP is known by someone, can he hack my smartphone?
Okay. Getting an IP is not a big deal. I'm again saying that getting an IP is not a big deal for anyone. Anyone, any website IP you can access. For example, you want to know what is the IP of a Google, what is the IP of a Facebook, just you go to the whois.com, you put the website, you will get the detail, what is the IP address, what is the hosting site, what is the Linux platform, what is the platform, every detail you can get for the organization, anything. But knowing an IP is not able to get into the system. No, if anyone gets your known to your IP, it will not get into the system, because IP is lost time, just kind of gate. I can say that there is a gate. IP means there is a gate present at the software, but it is not allowed to enter into the gate, because there will be security in the gate, in kind of encryption, in kind of communication, everything. I'm getting up. Because when you are using any type of communication system, for example, you are using any type of software, then you have to need to the physically access to install that software in your mobile. Otherwise, you cannot access the mobile from a remote location. No. So just gaining an IP address, it does not enable any attacker to gain into your mobile system.
Okay, thank you, sir. I just request Mr. Prabhat Panda, sir, to ask his questions directly to Sohan, sir.
Okay, one second. There is a question that how much reliable HTTP is against HTTP. Okay, HTTPS and HTTP. Suppose HTTP is a hypertext transfer protocol and S transfer security. But thing is that when it is secured, it is not provided by you. It is not provided by us. I am going to develop my HTTPS site. I will get the HTTPS site. No, it will be verified by the server provider. And there is a very much reliable thing, but thing is, I am again saying that it may be HTTPS site, it may be HTTP site, but you have must have to reliable on that website from your, you don't have to do any mistake. Simple thing is, that it may be a HTTPS website, but if you are going to do any mistake, we'll be vulnerable. Thing is, they rely on you, how are you going to deal with the different type of websites? Okay. Any question, Prabhat Pandey, sir?
Yeah, Mr. Pandey.
Yes, sir.
See, it's very nightmarish for any normal user to remember multiple passwords for yes, using in different websites, as it is strongly advised everywhere that you have to have different passwords for different websites. Mm-hmm. Now, in this connection, now the commercially available password vaults, are these reliable? Are these useful? Are these really safe to store all your passwords?
No, sir. I can certainly say the thing. Thing is that none of the software, none of the developer are so much reliable in our part. First thing is that because I am going from the last year. Suppose Facebook sold our all identity from Cambridge Analytica. Can we rely on Facebook? And it is on the document that the Mark Zuckerberg has already given the apology letter. That means we cannot rely on Facebook site. And how can we rely on Vault that was developed by some developer who don't know him? Because it was actually developed by the developer. In the later time, if someone pays a larger money or larger amount of money to him, he can sell our data. So we cannot rely on that person. Yes, in the many of the system we are using Google password or Google to remember the password, we can certainly believe Google will keep our identity secret, but it is not up to the mark that when simple thing is when one thing is public, it is vulnerable. I can say that we cannot say that it is secret. So simple thing, when you are using banking institution passwords, share market passwords, just remember it. Don't go for Google password, remember. And just that will be better. Physically write the password. If you don't remember, it will physically do something, but technically I am not it will not advisable to go for a password vault.
Okay, thank you. Just one last question from my end. Yes, we were mostly using mobile apps for banking transaction particularly.
Yes, sir.
So in a summarized form or just list out, can you please just advise what are the things for protection we should use, especially for the banking transaction or mobile apps?
Okay, sir. First thing is the installation. Installation means I have already detected that when you are downloading. The first thing is that actually how it works. First, a developer develops an APK or an Android app and he uploads to the Google. And the Google verifies all the scripts, all the coding through them. And after the verification of the Google, after verification of the code done by the Google, he approves that app that it is okay, go for it. And it will uploads to the Play Store. But thing is that there are kind of certain situation, 1 to 2 apps that were uploaded to the Play Store and were approved by Google. And later on, after 1 to 2 years, they were kind of mischievous things doing, stealing the identity. That was a mistake by the Google. We cannot say that. Because I have already told that there are two kinds of things. Either the developer can do the mistake or who can do the mistake. But that was later on, there was result solved by the Google. But at our can, what we'll do, if when you are downloading any type of apps, just verify it. It must be from Google Play Store and verify. Banking institution must be verified. That with there must be information like SBI developer verified. There will be some kind of tick. It must be verified for download. Second thing is that when you are using any mobile app, just for banking transaction, you are using mobile app. Okay, just go for mobile network. Don't go for Wi-Fi, public Wi-Fi. Just don't go for public Wi-Fi. It is a simple thing. Second thing is that any type of financial transaction that must be a double OTP system or double two-factor authorization. Two-factor authorization means that must be OTP because in some kind of in last 2 years, back to 2 years, there is a Google, there is an internet cafe present at Gold Bazar. What did he do? Actually, there is a limit. What is the limit you want to do? Suppose there is 10,000. below 10,000 limit, you don't need a OTP. Below 10,000 or above 10,000 limit, you need a OTP. These are kind of systems given by the financial institution for the submoner is reliable transaction, the ease of transaction, but don't go for it. I suggest every transaction must be go through an OTP, two-factor authorization. There must be a 1 rupee transaction, or there may be a 1 lakh transaction. That was the thing that was done by the Golbojar. He was kind of thing is that below 10,000, there will be no OTP. There will be direct transaction. Then the boy working that internet cafe, you take the advantage of that situation. So I suggest go for already. There is a setting in the final only any banking sites. What are the limit that you go want for OTP? You make it every transaction. These are the three advice I will give.
Thank you, sir. Sir, you another very question from one of the learners. They want to know whether there is any standard operating procedure in website hacking investigation.
Okay. Actually, the thing is that when there is a website crime, there is not a standard procedure. Okay. There is something kind of procedure. Ek cheez hai, Hindi mein bolte na. चोर डाल डाल जाए तो पुलिस को पता पता जाना पड़ता है काइंड ऑफ थिंग सो फॉर एवरी टाइम द स्टीलिंग द टेक्नोलॉजी यूज्ड बाय द अटैकर दे आर डेवलपिंग बट देन देयर कैन नॉट बी अ स्टैंडर्ड प्रोसीजर दैट वी आर गोइंग टू इन्वेस्टिगेट इफ द स्टैंडर्ड प्रोसीजर इज प्रेजेंट देयर दैट इज ऑल्सो नोन टू द थीव्स एंड देयर गोइंग टू अडॉप्ट द थिंग्स और देयर गोइंग टू इम्प्रोवाइज द थिंग्स टू अटैक द थिंग्स सो दैट्स व्हाई यू हैव टू बी एक्सप्लोर ऑल द पॉसिबिलिटीज If going from the standard procedure, going for the standard procedure like you are sniffing the packets, analyzing the statistics, these are kind of standard procedures to analyze the problem. But after, if you want to catch a thief or if you want to attack something, then you have to go for any extra idea out of the box. I don't go for standard procedure.
Okay, thank you, sir. Sir, there is another question. How do I become a professional ethical hacker? Please give some suggestion.
Okay, if you want to go for a professional ethical hacker, first do the two things. First, you have to learn computer science very much and you must have adequate knowledge. Just go, don't be a script kiddie. Just using someone's script to access something, that's not going to work. You have to very much knowledge, vast knowledge about programming language, network security, encryption, decryption. These are kind of things we have to learn about. Encryption, what is hash algorithm, what is a system, how does it work, how programming language work, how server work, how IP, DNS. These are the kind of things. First, you have to concentrate on the things. And after the things you get attached, there is a professional course developed or institution given by present at Delhi. There is different kind of institution organization they are giving ethical hacking courses, but there is a certification. But I cannot say, I only say that it will be there is standard. Then you do things, you do these things to become a hacker. But actually, to be a hacker, you have to be explorative. You have to be, I make idea that is out of the box. Without that, you cannot go for it. Okay.
Thank you, sir. Because the session is so much interesting, most of our learners wants your contact number as well as your mail ID. So I would like to request you if you can share it in the chat box, that then they can easily convey their doubts. They can easily contact with you for any doubt clearance.
Yes, sure, madam. I am giving my contact number and my email ID. Okay, I have just given my email ID 9777339851. Hello, ma'am.
I would like to request Amit sir to share that in the chat box.
Ma'am, it is available in the chat box, and anybody who wants to contact Mr. Pandey sir can look into the chat box, and I'll also set this email ID and contact number in the chat box.
Okay, thank you sir. I guess there is some network issue at my end. Once again, I am thanking Sohan sir for such a lively session, and thank you all the learners. Thank you the technical team, Amit sir, and all other staffs. Thank you so much.
Thank you, madam.
Hello, Amit sir.
Yes, sir.
Recording the stop कर दो इसे.
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you, learners, for your participation, and the session is over.